This is the flight computer I'm going to be using on all my rockets going forward. Its name is AVA, and it stands for All Vehicle Avionics. First, let's talk about the hardware, then we'll talk about the software. AVA uses three separate microcontrollers which can work together over I2C or SPI. On the left is the navigation computer, or NAV. This processes all of the data from the inertial measurement unit, GPS, barometer, and any other sensors I might connect. It uses all those to come up with an estimate of where the vehicle is, how fast it's moving, where it's pointing, all of those things. On the right is the telemetry computer, or TLM. This microcontroller handles all external communications on the vehicle. For ground operation, TLM uses a Bluetooth low energy radio to send out and receive data, usually through a phone or handheld device. It also has a small connector on the top left to connect to a 900 megahertz radio, which is much better for long range communications while the vehicle's in flight. The TLM computer handles the sending and receiving of all external data and then passes it off to the MPU, or main processing unit. This is the central processor on the board, and it handles all real-time operations on board the rocket. Using data from the navigation computer, it handles all of the control commands for the thrust vector control system, reaction wheels, parachutes, secondary motor ignitions, etc. Anything that physically moves on the rocket is controlled by the MPU. In terms of outputs, let's work our way around the board, starting at the bottom. Down here, we have 8 PWM outputs. 4 are labeled for fins, and 4 for thrust vector control hardware. As AVA is for all vehicles, these can be split up in any which way. The pins can be configured to run off of regulated 5-volt power or direct from a lithium polymer battery by bridging a small solder pad on the back. Now, there are 6 total pyro channels, but on the left, we have the 4 main channels. Each one of these channels can comfortably sit at 5 amps of current and has continuity sensing to ensure that charges are connected and ready to fire. Although most charges I fly are bidirectional, I do like to label the positive and negative terminals here. I feel like it's a good idea, no matter what, to always label which direction current is flowing. In the upper left, we have pyro channel 6, I2C lines for the navigation computer, regular GPIO on the nav, a 5-volt power terminal, and several pins from the main processor. On the top, we have SPI outputs for the main processor, several more GPIO, a 3-volt power terminal, and reaction wheel roll control outputs. Coming down on the right side, we have even more GPIO from the main processing unit, I2C lines from the main processor, a second 5-volt power terminal, and the high and low lines for a CAN bus. Near the bottom right, we have a battery input good for anywhere between 5 and 32 volts. Below that, we have a battery output post switch. You'll see this labeled as 12 volts, as most of my rockets fly on a 3-cell lithium polymer battery, which has a nominal voltage around 12. Then we have a terminal for an external switch. The switch that's on the PCB itself is not good for sending lots of current through it, and especially in high shock or vibration environments, you don't want something like this to control your entire avionics system. So we have a switch terminal on the side to totally bypass the switch altogether. Finally, we have an arming terminal, which when bridged, will allow any of the pyro channels to fire. Without bridging this terminal, they're all electrically disconnected and can't fire. Moving back up to the middle, we have 3 different USB ports. One is for each microcontroller on board. We also have an SD card slot for storing flight data and accessing lookup tables or pre-generated flight paths. Finally, all the way back up at the top of the board, we have outputs for the 900 MHz radio, an SMA connector for the GNSS antenna, and a UFL connector for the Bluetooth antenna. I opted for external antennas for both the GNSS radio and the Bluetooth radio because if AVA ever flies in a carbon fiber airframe, that's something that RF can't pass through, and so you want the ability to break out that antenna to the outside of the vehicle or somewhere where the RF can pass through. With all of that done, let's talk about the specific sensors and devices I'm using on this board. And before we do that, a quick disclaimer. It does not matter what sensors you use. It does not matter what processors you use, what devices you select, how you design your board. There is always a better option, and often there is already someone typing a snarky comment about it. When you build something for yourself, you are the only person who gets to define the metrics by which you select chips, sensors, processors, anything for your board or a project in general. All that is to say that every chip that I put on this board is there for a reason, even if the reason isn't abundantly clear. A lot of the time when I'm selecting something, I'm doing it because there's an existing user base or because I already know how to use that one device. There's always a better option, and again, I'm sure there's someone already in the comments angry about something I did. The MPU is a Mark 20 DX256 by NXP, formerly Freescale, with a normal clock speed of 72 megahertz and the ability to overclock up to 96 megahertz. It has more power than you would realistically need for what it's doing on this computer. It's the same processor and basic schematic layout as the Teensy 3.2 by PJRC. The NAV and TLM computers are both Atmel Atsam D21 chips. Normal clock speed of 48 megahertz and the same processor as Signal R2, Impulse, Relay, Arc, Spark, etc. This is obviously my favorite processor as it sits in a wonderful little sweet spot of processing power and GPIO. These two chips, the Mark 20 and the D21, were chosen primarily because of my history with them. I've used both of these in a bunch of different computers and have a really high degree of familiarity with them. As mentioned before, there are always better options. Nothing that you see here is the right way to do it. It's just what was right for me. The GNSS radio is a uBlox Zoe M8Q. For almost all of my flights, a COCOM unlocked GPS is not needed. I'm not going faster than 500 meters per second. I'm not going higher than 50,000 meters. With that said, I'm still trying to get a few unlocked units of the Zoe M8Q, but it is proving difficult. If you work at uBlox or know someone who does, or you think you can help, I would love some help on that front. There are a few projects that would benefit from COCOM unlocked units. I selected the Zoe M8Q because it communicates really well over I2C, which is a breath of fresh air in a sea of GPS radios that do it over serial. Why? Why? It's so slow! I'm sorry, I don't know what happened there. Must have blacked out for a second. The Bluetooth module is a Nordic Semiconductor NRF8001. It's a chip I've used for a few years now, and I wouldn't have included it had I not already built it into a bunch of different boards, like Signal and Arc and Relay. I have a whole code base that's based around this chip at this point, and I just wouldn't have included it had I not had that already working. It probably isn't worth it if you already have a regular telemetry radio going on there. The primary IMU connected to the navigation computer is the Bosch BNO055. This selection is interesting and on the whole kind of suboptimal. The sensor itself is fine, but I'm not using any of the fancy sensor fusion features on there. I'm pulling direct from the gyroscopes, accelerometers, and magnetometers. I selected this sensor once again because I knew it really well. I've used it on a bunch of different boards, and at this point, the library I'm using is pretty custom. AVA is being produced in really low volume, so it doesn't matter if there are small cost inefficiencies like this. There is a secondary, lower quality IMU on the back of the board. That is an ST Microelectronics LSM6DS3. During normal flight, it's not used at all except to just log to sensor data as a backup, but I'll explain that a bit more later. The barometer is a TE MS5611. This is kind of a fancy little print of a sensor with really high accuracy. I selected it for its ability to perform well at very high altitudes when you can no longer get help from GPS. Finally, there's a Rohm Semiconductor KX134 high G accelerometer on board, which is good to plus or minus 64G. I don't plan on pulling 64G anytime soon, but there are several flight profiles that I have in the works which will exceed the 16G capability of the other IMUs. Before we end this little hardware section, the board itself is a four-layer PCB designed in Eagle. Pretty standard by most specs. The board thickness is 1.6 millimeters. The minimum trace width is 0.15 millimeters, as well as the minimum clearance. This board specifically is 1 ounce copper, but if you want the full capability of the Pyro channels, you would want to manufacture it as 2 ounce copper. Most of the passive components on the back are a size 060. And I do my best to orient them all in the same direction, which is helpful for boards being manufactured by a machine. I like to lay out most of my major processors and sensors at a 45 degree angle, as it usually makes it easier to access the pins I need. It also makes things look a lot cooler, especially when they're kind of symmetric. For most of my PCBs, I also put most of the major components on the front with all of the passive components on the back. This is a small price to pay in terms of routing and vias on the board, but it's one that I deem worth it, and it also looks way cooler this way. I run a YouTube channel and have to present most of my designs to a large audience, so there's a non-zero amount of aesthetics to be considered with every design. In order to fly this board safely in the humid climate that I live in, I also conformal coated it. I'm using a silicone conformal coat here, and after letting it dry for about 48 hours, I tossed it in the bathroom and cranked on the shower. I ran several of these tests both on the Ava flight computer and on the Impulse launch computer. With the coated board, I brought everything up to 100% humidity, held it there for a while, and then brought it back down, testing the functionality of the board as we went. And then to verify as a control, I took one of the uncoated Ava boards, ran the same tests, and observed failures once we got to high enough humidity levels.
So we're at 91% humidity, 71.9 degrees. And when I power on the board, it no longer starts up nominally. We get the telemetry computer responding, but the MPU and the navigation computer can't make it through startup. And here's what's happening. If I plug the main processor in, and then we take a look at the serial output here, we see that we get a connection to the telemetry computer, but there's a communication error on the I2C bus, which is the exact same behavior that we had when we had the humidity failure on Sprint Flight 10. So again, this is 92% humidity, and it looks like the test is validated because the I2C bus is jammed somehow by the humidity.
Okay, now it is time to talk about software, and that's where most of the complexity lies with most of the stuff I build. All of the flight software is written in C++. I work on it in the VS Code IDE with the Platform.io add-on, and each microcontroller is using its original Arduino-based bootloader. I'm still working in the Arduino environment by a technical sense. I was embarrassed about this for a little while, sticking to the Arduino platform, but there's no reason to be. Just because it's for beginners doesn't mean you can't do cool things with it. And so, shamelessly, all of my boards are still pretty much Arduinos. As I mentioned, the link between the processors can be either SPI or I2C. I'm only using I2C right now as it's a communication protocol I understand pretty well. We're getting anywhere between 0.5 and 80 hertz of communication rates, but that really depends on the priority of the data we're sending back and forth. We can certainly go higher on the data rates if we need to. We're nowhere near the theoretical limit, but at a certain point, you're just wasting clock cycles. Every packet of data that gets passed back and forth between the processors is terminated with a checksum, and if the checksum doesn't pass, then we set an error flag high, and then that gets logged in our data logging process. Every loop in the flight software is flexible, and this is a little hard to explain, but if you've done it before, you know what I'm talking about. Basically, we can run the computer as fast, as slow as we need to, or the computer can have hiccups or speed bumps or whatever, but all of the loop timing is dynamic and measured so that we never have problems if the computer accidentally slows down or something like that. It's a little weird to have three microcontrollers working together like this, and I'll tell you what, if I were gonna do this again, I'd probably just find something that was multi-core or multi-threaded. The reason I didn't wanna use one single threaded processor is that on Sprite, there were a few operations that took much longer than I wanted. Connecting to the IMU was done entirely over a serial data line, as well as transmitting telemetry, and those operations, although they take, you know, 10 milliseconds, maybe 15 milliseconds, that's actually a very long time in a real-time control system. Basically, each microcontroller has its own little specialty that it gets to focus on without bogging down the other processors with really lengthy serial writes or serial prints, so that we're not pigeonholed into doing mission-critical things over the slowest communications protocol ever invented. I'm sorry, I blacked out again. I should talk to someone about that. Let's continue. The nav computer is doing its own integration of the gyroscopes and accelerometers at 400 hertz on its own little I2C bus. I'm using a sort of asynchronous Kalman filter to get our position and velocity estimates with the accelerometer. And the asynchronous part is that while the prediction step of the Kalman filter is running continuously at 400 hertz, the update step doesn't run until we have new GNSS data, and that's a flexible amount of time. I wrote the filter primarily by using this book, which I will link below, and then I tuned it by spending a lot of time outside on my driveway. I used a little cart with Ava riding on it to go back and forth and see if our measurements matched up with the real-world measurements in position and velocity. The filter also does live accelerometer bias calculations, which is a bit of a flex, but I worked really hard on it and it was very difficult to get right, so I have to tell someone. But it's mostly cool because it just means we can fly Ava for a very long time while it still gets accurate position and velocity estimates. The TLM computer is pushing out telemetry at between 30 and 40 hertz, and it's pretty inefficient right now. We're sending all of the data as equal priority through one string, and this UART connection between the TLM computer and the 900 megahertz radio is relatively slow, taking a few milliseconds each time. That's one of the reasons the TLM computer is broken out by itself. Whenever the MPU has data that it wants to send to the ground, it passes it to the TLM computer over I2C with a bunch of checksums, and then the TLM computer handles the slow reading and writing over serial through the 900 megahertz radio. Finally, as mentioned, the MPU handles all of the control operations and is really the heart of AVA. The MPU also handles all of the data logging on board. Right now we're logging to flash about 67 channels at 50 hertz. This is really flexible as we write one big struct to a page of flash every time we write. So we can change the data types, we can change how many channels there are. Basically, we just have 256 bytes each time we write. In terms of fault tolerance, we do have some redundancy on the board itself, although it's not set up in the software yet. If the navigation computer ever sets one of its error flags high, or we go into a state where we can't communicate with it, that puts us in a really tough spot when we're in the air. That's why we have that backup IMU, which is on the back of the board. That's connected directly to the MPU, directly to the control computer. It's low quality, we don't have GPS, it's really cheap, but it is enough to get us home if we really need it and we're in a tight spot. And again, while it's not fully fleshed out in the software, it's pretty easy to detect if something's wrong. Fault detection is not that hard with these types of sensors. The GPS has a bunch of different metrics that you can look at to determine if the signal is accurate. We already have a bit of logic in the common filter that deals with really high acceleration events and then throws out bad data or data that it deems to be irrelevant. And finally, for fault tolerance on the pyro channels, we have these small resistors which act as fuses. In the event of a short circuit, if we pull functionally infinite current, these will be the first things to fail instead of the MOSFET, which could connect directly back to one of the processors. So we can essentially retain functionality of the board in a really hard failure event. On AVA R1, I omitted these guys and accidentally shorted one of the pyro channels at one point, and I paid the price for it. Though, as I mentioned on Twitter, I am really pleased with the results of our testing in building a flight computer slash pyrotechnic device hybrid. And so that's it for AVA R2. In terms of the changes between revision 1 and revision 2, they aren't that many. The biggest change was a swap of the high G accelerometer to something better suited. We also changed the power management system. AVA R1 overheated quite a bit, and so that's fixed on this one. I've got 10 AVA R2 boards that are, as we speak, in manufacturing right now. A few of those are already slated for dedicated missions, both for me and for other people. Now, I don't plan on selling these publicly, but I'm willing to work with people on an individual case-by-case basis. AVA R2 doesn't have that fancy front-end app and everything like Signal R2 does, so it is not for the non-engineer. If you have a serious inquiry about purchasing AVA to fly on something you're building, please let me know. I'll put a contact link in the description. And that's all from me. Thank you for watching. My name's Joe Barnard. May your skies be blue and your winds be low.